back, family. This is Dr. Umar Johnson, the Prince of Pan-Africanism. I'm coming to you live and direct from London, England, in the United Kingdom. I am here, and I am with my big brother, the incomparable poet from Jamaica, Mr. Stephen Razor himself, Muta Baruka. Join us this Saturday, November the 3rd, right here in London for a power-packed program and presentation on the state of the Pan-African world. It's going down Saturday, November the 3rd. Doors open up at 6 p.m. Muta Baruka and Dr. Umar at the Lighthouse in London. The Lighthouse, Saturday, November the 3rd. Get your tickets at SiriusTickets.com. That's S-I-R-I-U-S Tickets.com. I repeat, S-I-R-I-U-S Tickets.com or call 075-067-25345. I repeat, 075-067-25345. SiriusTickets.com, the Prince of Pan-Africanism, Muta Baruka. We are here. Powerful year-end revolutionary message. Saturday night in London, November 3rd. The Lighthouse, be there or be square. Black African power. You get artists who say, it's not my responsibility to be responsible with my content. I'm not the reason we have murders. I'm not the reason young brothers in the UK are killing each other. I'm not the reason children are dropping out of school. You may not be the reason. That's correct. But your music influences the behavior of the people who listen to it. No, you didn't create violence. But you can motivate more violence, and you can advertise violence by glamorizing it in your music. See, the artist has a very critical responsibility in our community. Their job is to, yes, tell their experience. I'm talking about violence because I lived through violence. I talk about jail because I went to jail. I understand. But the artist not only has a responsibility to reflect experience, the artist also has a responsibility to project a new reality. And although I see a lot of our artists here in the UK reflecting their experience, I don't see them necessarily projecting a new reality. And that's where I would criticize the UK artists. Don't just tell me what we're going through. Tell me where we need to go. I believe that any artist who is serious and concerned about the future of our people has to, above the rhythm and the rhyme of the music, they must be thoroughly focused upon their content. What is the message within the sound? Because it is the message that is going to condition and influence the minds of the youth, not the rhythm. So we need the rhythm to be attractive, but we also need the message to also be attractive. So they need to make sure that they are injecting responsible, positive, African-centered, revolutionary content into the music. Because we need to understand something. Music can influence more than direct instruction. Music is very powerful because music and images are the messages of the soul. The soul learns through sound and the soul learns through images. This is why they say a picture is worth a thousand words. I could teach a kid all year that Jesus is black, Jesus is black, Jesus is black. But if they see a picture of a white Jesus, that white Jesus will stick in their mind more than an entire year of book learning. Because everything stored in the human mind is stored as an image. Music, on the other hand, makes the subconscious receptive to whatever message is put to that rhythm. This is why in traditional African culture, whenever the griots would speak, whenever the kings and queens would speak, there would always be a rhythm in the background of the speech. This is where hip-hop comes from, okay? Hip-hop is in a continuation of talking over the music. The reason the music was put in the background is because our unconscious minds can learn better and are more receptive to information when it is put to a rhythm. So let's look at the videos. The music videos are very powerful because now you take the image and you match it with the rhythm. And so now you have both languages of the soul picture and sound working together to indoctrinate the unconscious of your population. So I would argue that artists in the United Kingdom, our African British brothers and sisters who are in the artistic arena, have to be responsible for their artwork, because what they are doing is going to leave a much longer impact upon the minds of our youth than anything they learn in the school. With that being said, I want to clarify that I am not lumping all hip-hop into the same category. We have dozens, hundreds of conscious, progressive black hip-hop artists. Y'all have them here in the UK as well, but they don't get the same quality of coverage. And the reason they don't get the same quality of coverage is, number one, we in the community are not pushing the positive artists, okay? And I hope you guys are doing that with your platform. You have to push the positive conscious artists. That's number one. And number two, the white European music mega companies are not interested in positive rap, because the European agenda for African people is extermination. And the only music content they're going to endorse is content that sees us going to jail or going to the cemetery. I applaud Stormzy. I applaud him for using his platform to do something positive that can affect our young people. Obviously, without a college-educated population of young Africans, we won't get more doctors, engineers, surgeons, psychologists, educators, pharmacists. In order to have a black middle class, you gotta have college-educated black youth, right? Mm. So I support what he's doing. However, I want to add a little piece of constructive criticism, because what he's doing, LeBron James is doing in the United States. Oprah Winfrey has done it in the United States, and I applaud it. My only piece of constructive criticism is this. More African British youth getting college educations is not automatically going to lead to an improvement in a quality of life systematically for all African people. And the reason I'm saying that is because the white power structure doesn't give out jobs to black people. A college education does not guarantee employment. In the United States, we have over 2 million African Americans right now with master's degrees and doctorate degrees who are unemployed. They cannot find work. I have resumes on my email list from lawyers, black attorneys, who cannot find work. College is not a recipe for employment. So what I would like to see happen with our entrepreneurs, again, I'm supporting what he's doing, I want to be clear. But as he moves forward in helping our young people, I want him to begin to segue away from the college education to economic empowerment. In other words, instead of paying $100,000 for an African youth in the UK to go to Cambridge, how about you give them a $100,000 small business loan so they can open up a music studio, open up a restaurant, open up a school for our young people, open up a car repair shop where they can teach other young men how to fix automobiles. Are you following me?
Absolutely.
In other words, when you pay for college education, that money don't go to us. That money goes to the university. It doesn't go to our pocket. It goes into the university's pocket. We need that money to come back into our community. So rather than paying for college, pay for economic empowerment by investing in small businesses for our young people. I told LeBron James, not directly, but in a message that I sent to him by video, I appreciate what you're doing, brother. But instead of putting 1,000 black kids through college, how about giving 1,000 black kids a $100,000 grant to start a small business and then pair them up with a business mentor who can walk them through the process of starting that business and see to it that their business survives well beyond the five-year limit that they normally give to black folks. You follow what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
The college education is good. Economic empowerment is better.
Well, the influence of money in the life of the black artists. Beliefs determine behavior. The situation doesn't make the man, it reveals the man. The money isn't the problem.
A 20-year-old multi-millionaire black male, that should be a blessing. That should be businesses, that should be schools, that should be import-export, that should be hospitals, that should be banks. A multi-millionaire black youth should be a blessing. The reason it's a curse isn't because they have the money. It's because they were not raised, trained, and groomed in the art of financial management for oppressed populations. They don't know what to do with their money other than waste it. And this is why many of them will get rich fast and get broke even faster. You see, a fool and his money will soon part. African proverb, you understand. And my problem ain't with the artists. My problem is with the black community. It's the elders who are not raising these babies with the revolutionary responsibility that would motivate them to take some of this liquid money and reinvest it in the black community. I've always said, the only thing a black celebrity is allowed to do with their money is spend it on stuff that white folks sell them. The only thing a black celebrity is allowed to do with their money is spend it on things that white folks sell them. Why you see rappers with 25 cars, 30 houses, 100 pair of sneakers? You don't need all that. You know why they have all that? Because they're not allowed to do nothing else with their money. You see, there's a lot of hip-hop artists in the States who support my work. They text me, they hang out with me, they call me. You can name all the multi-Grammy Award winners. They love Dr. Umar. They watch my videos. They come backstage and shake my hand, take a picture, but they will never be seen in the light of day with me. Why? Because their livelihood is paid for by white folks. And being seen in public with Dr. Umar Johnson is hazardous to their health. You understand? So you got to recognize all this behavior is taking place within a political context that glamorizes reckless, conspicuous consumption and demoralizes revolutionary economics. But let me say this. The financially irresponsible black recording artist is only a microcosm of a larger macrocosm, which is the African community itself, African American, African British, African Canadian, African Caribbean, African on the continent, that is also irresponsible with their money. I mean, let's keep in mind, in 2017, black women spent $9 billion on European hair care products, perms and weaves and stuff, right? Black men spent $4 billion on liquor and alcohol, $2 billion on Air Jordans, $1 billion on fast food. Look at this. This is not the rappers. This is us, regular black folks. So if we are irresponsible with our money as adults, why would our children be any more responsible with their money as youth? The apple don't fall far from the tree. And the current generation of young recording artists are nothing but an exaggeration of the mistakes and irresponsible, dysfunctional behaviors of the adults who raised them. ADHD was invented in 1980 by the American Psychiatric Association. It's no coincidence that it was invented in 1980. That's the same year that the CIA, Central Intelligence Agency, aka Cocaine Import Agency, dropped crack off to the black community as a means of destroying the Black Power Movement. The Black Power Movement was effectively killed with the CIA's importation of crack in the 1980s. 1979 was the last year for black power, okay? Chemical warfare. The same thing the British did to the Chinese, the United States government did to black America, okay? So as a result of the drug epidemic in the black community, millions of black men were ushered off to prison, leaving the mothers at home to raise black boys by themselves. With this vacuum of a father left to be filled, this void, the government stepped in with ADHD. Since there was no daddy, they would make the doctor the new father. Because there was no daddy at home, they would make the doctor the new father. And so now, instead of the father providing discipline and structure and boundaries and limitations for his son, now you just send him to the doctor. And the doctor writes him a prescription for Ritalin, Adderall, Concerta, Amitriptyline, synthesized forms of cocaine. Mind you, the same drug that took his father out of the house. The father is in jail for selling cocaine. Right? But you're going to give a modified form of that same cocaine that locked his father up. You're going to give it to his son, a child, in school, long enough to be miseducated by middle-class white females. Look at the hypocrisy of that. I locked your father up for selling it, but I'm going to give it to you so you can sit still and learn about Christopher Columbus, you see. So that was 1980. ADD. Attention Deficit Disorder, ADD. 1987, it became ADHD. Why did they add the H? They added the word hyperactivity to the diagnosis and the definition because there's no drug that can make you pay attention. There's no drug that can make you pay attention. So, when you diagnose a child with ADD, there's no prescription. When you diagnose a child with ADHD, there's a prescription. So guess what they did? Not only did they add ADHD, they took away ADD. So if your son is only inattentive, his only problem is that he does not focus, right? You can no longer just say he's ADD. No more. You have to say he's ADHD. Why? To justify the medication. This is not about mental health. This is not about helping kids. This is about a multi-billion dollar psychopharmaceutical industrial complex that makes billions of dollars a year drugging up black boys in the UK with the same drugs that sent their fathers to prison. ADHD is a weapon of mass destruction, and that other weapon of mass destruction is known as special education. The deliberate misdiagnosing of black boys in London, Birmingham, Luton, Wolverhampton, Bristol, Leeds, with reading disabilities, math disabilities, learning disabilities that they do not have. ADHD does not exist, neither does the learning disability. But these are the two weapons that they use to crush the futures and potentials of black boys from the Caribbean to the United States, to the United Kingdom, to Canada, and it's even in Africa. In Africa, some of the African countries are now allowing the Western pharmaceutical companies to come in and prescribe psychiatric medications for our children. Black parents, listen to me. Do not get your child evaluated for ADHD. Do not allow them to be prescribed psychiatric medication for no reason except if they are suicidal, if they are homicidal, if they are schizophrenic. If your child is not threatening their own safety, if they're not threatening the safety of another child, and if they do not suffer from paranoid delusions and hallucinations, they should not be on drugs. The only drug they need is love. When I started the fundraiser to build the Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey RBG International Leadership Academy for Pan-African Excellence, a lot of people questioned, why is building a school the most important thing that you can do for our people at this time? They said, we don't understand this. You're one of the most requested speakers in the world. You have more videos on YouTube than any black scholar in the world. Why are you trying to build a school? Why not build an army? Why not buy some land and start a black nation? Why is Dr. Umar Johnson starting out with a school with all the power and support that he has in the diaspora? The answer is real simple. Before you can have an economic revolution, before you can have a political revolution, before you can have a spiritual revolution, before we can have a black family revolution, we have to have a what? intellectual, psychological revolution. If you don't change the African mind, you change nothing else about the African reality. If you don't change the African mind, you change nothing else about the African reality. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. If I was to build an African military, Pan-African military, I'm going to go out and buy weapons, right? And I'm going to give these weapons to self-hating black men all over the world. What will those self-hating black men be doing with those weapons in 24 hours? Killing each other. Do you follow me?
Absolutely.
So until you change the way we think, you don't change nothing else. Dr. Carter G. Woodson, father of black history, in his seminal work, Miseducation of the Negro, what did he say? If you control a man's thinking, you do not have to worry about his actions. If you control a man's thinking, you don't have to tell him to go to the back door. He will go to the back door on his own. And guess what? When he gets to the back, if there is no door, he will make one to walk through. So if we want to resurrect African culture, if we want to resurrect African spirituality, if we want to resurrect and rebuild the African family, we have to resurrect and rebuild the African mind. So for me, there is nothing more important for Dr. Umar Johnson to do at this point in my life than to change the thinking of African children. Because until we do that, anything else we do will be a waste of time. And that's why I'm starting with FDMG.
Great. Also, do you have any plans of creating a Pan-African model in the UK that links directly to you?
Yes. Once we build the first school, God willing, we'll have it by New Year's Day. God willing. Once we have the first school, the second school is going to be Africa, okay? The third school, I would like to be the United Kingdom, okay? I'm going to push for that. The problem is the UK government is a much more stringent government to navigate in terms of opening an independent school from the outside. You follow me? But if the Chinese can have a school here, if the Jews can have a school here, if the Arabs can have a school here, then why can't the Africans have a school here? You understand? So the third school, I will look to build it here in the United Kingdom.
Good stuff.
And to that point, if there's any revolutionary black attorneys out there, I need revolutionary black, not coons, not Toms, not Negroes, but black barristers in the UK who think progressively and have a Pan-African mindset, I'd like them to get in contact with me to start doing the investigation into what we got to do to make FDMG London and FDMG Birmingham and FDMG Luton and FDMG Warminster and FDMG Manchester a reality. So we're going to make that happen. Peace and love, black family. This is the Prince of Pan-Africanism, Dr. Umar Johnson, King Kong Consciousness, International Ifatunde himself. If you ever need to reach out to me for any reason, shoot me an email, drumarjohnson@yahoo.com. That's D-R-U-M-A-R Johnson@yahoo.com. You can telephone me by way of WhatsApp, 215-989-9858, 215-989-9858. Instagram and Twitter at Dr. Umar Johnson, and on Facebook, Dr. Umar Ifatunde. Black parents, I have a free Sunday morning teleconference call that I do every Sunday, 7 a.m., Eastern Standard Time. If you have questions about your child with regard to education and mental health, you can call 857-232-0158, 857-232-0158, access code 870-864-POUND, 870-864-POUND. Please continue to send your donations in to the Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey Academy, payable to FDMG Academy, P.O. Box 6872, Philadelphia, P.A., 19132. Black Power, Universal African Unity, Marcus Garvey yesterday, Marcus Garvey today, and Dr. Umar tomorrow. Black Power. Whenever I'm chilling in the United Kingdom, whenever I'm hanging out with the brothers and sisters in the UK, I'm checking out Link Up TV, and you need to do it as well. Dr. Umar Johnson and Link Up TV, we roll out together. Black Power.